Welcome to ATP Report. I'm Barry Nussbaum. With just a few days to go before the election, the final debate has become critically important. We have a very special guest with us today to help analyze what just happened in the exchanges between President Trump and former Vice President Joe Biden. Daniel Greenfield is here. As you probably know, he is the Shulman Fellow at the David Horowitz Freedom Center. He's an author, he's a political commentator extraordinaire, and we're very happy to have him back with us. Welcome, Daniel.
Thank you, it's a pleasure to be back.
All right, let's kick this off with our big expert. Based on the polling that shows COVID seems to be trending as the number one issue in the campaign, Joe Biden pushed hard on Trump's failure to respond, as he put it, and blamed all 200,000 people who have died on President Trump in some very emotional look into the camera moments. Is that a fair statement that Biden blames all that on Trump, and is his plan different? I mean, Trump shut down China and some people say he might have saved as many as 2 million lives. What are your thoughts?
Well, Biden doesn't actually have a plan. He kept emphasizing wearing masks as if that's a solution. Mind you, his own party has repeatedly backed huge mass rallies with large numbers of people, whether it's the 50,000 Sharpton rally in D.C., the Black Lives Matter / riots across America, the Women's March now, which are obviously blatantly in defiance of the same orders that he's actually proposing. His party has not produced any kind of plan. He kept mumbling something about contact tracing. He has nothing new to offer there. Now, as far as who's to blame for the death toll, we can go back and forth as to whether the virus could have been kept out of America. It does seem as if it was here earlier than the kind of official numbers have it, which would suggest that not shutting down, might not have made that much of a difference. Bottom line is a lot of the fall also came out of Europe. The shutdown should have been there. This is an area where, again, New York authorities fundamentally failed. Governor Cuomo early on promised to track down the first woman who was infected. He failed to do basic contact tracing there. He's got his bestseller book now, which he boasts is in number 7 on the New York Times bestseller list. Meanwhile, you've got a death toll of tens of thousands in New York. And the second virus resurgence, which he's trying to blame on religious Jews, but that's deeply dishonest. Bottom line is, when you look at the death toll, much of it is urban. Much of it is concentrated in blue urban areas, in blue states. Only later, it took months and months and months for it to actually make its way to more rural areas. These were failures that happened in Democrat states. In some cases, these were failures that were absolutely unforced. For example, Cuomo, Governor Whitmer, Governor Wolf in Pennsylvania, Governor Murphy, New Jersey, Governor Newsom in California, and I'm just listing some of them, forced nursing homes to accept infected coronavirus patients. They made this mandatory. This led to a huge death toll. And again, about a third of the national death toll has been concentrated in nursing homes. We've seen absolutely devastating impact in nursing homes. This is something Republicans have absolutely failed to communicate. It's something they need to communicate. It's something they need to push back when you start talking about these 200,000 dead. So many of these 200,000 dead are blood that are on their hands. This was not about masks. This was, do not send infected patients into nursing homes, full stop.
Well, let's talk about the next step. Trump pushed hard in the debate, Daniel, to open the country up, that, as he put it, the cure is worse than the disease. And Trump can't open the country. It's up to the states. However, Biden pushed hard, if necessary, to close everything down, I guess, from the federal level. Who's right and why?
It absolutely makes no sense to have what Biden called for national standards. You're dealing with this at a local level. Federalizing this is not going to make things more efficient. We've seen how the federal government deals with things. Making every county dependent and trying to track every single number and having to go to the federal government permission to do anything would be a complete bureaucratic disaster, and we already know how that is. It would not work. But the Democrats are absolutely committed to having some sort of national strategy. And of course, this would enable them to punish some of their political enemies as a result. If you can do that, if you can crack down on areas and particular businesses. We've seen this during the so-called Obama recovery period, where they specifically targeted industries that were more conservative, while at the same time funding and bailing out industries that produced more of their donors. And this is the other problem that happens. You have corruption. When you give this much power to a centralized federal authority, it's going to be widely abused. It's going to mean that there will be lobbyists going in there, lobbying for every particular industry. It's going to mean complete abuse and double standards. It's going to mean that if you're a huge corporation, you're going to be able to get an exemption. If you're a small business, you're not going to be able to. This is the Biden solution, and it would be absolutely un-American.
Well, let's shift gears for a second here, Daniel. The first debate, you had Chris Wallace, who is a Democrat, although he's a regular on Fox. And as Fox put him up as a conservative, he seemed to debate Trump every time Biden needed the help. And Trump actually made a comment about that. Last debate, there was Kristi Welker, who is a registered Democrat. And according to the count that I saw, she interrupted Trump 10 times more then she interrupted Biden. What do you think of the job she did?
You know, the question is, do presidential debates need moderators? Back in the day, they did not have moderators. You could have, when there was a more widowed country, you could have presidential candidates exchanging ideas 100 years ago without having a person there sitting there and saying, we're not going to talk about climate change. Now we're going to talk about race relations. This is frankly childish, and we could sort of tolerate it. We could have the media putting their brand person out there, back when there was at least some pretense of professionalism. Because what we're seeing here is not professionalism, it's very blatant intervention. And pretty much anybody the media is going to put up, even if it's Fox News, bottom line is Fox News is run by most of the same people who run ABC News or NBC or CNN behind the scenes. You're still going to be dealing with the same people. Presidential debates don't need moderators. If you're running to be able to lead a country, you shouldn't need a moderator. You should be able to actually speak for yourself. And if we absolutely need to have some sort of control over the debate, have the 2 minutes, have the muting automatically, and that's that.
Well, you know, speaking of CNN, Daniel, very, very wacky, I hate Donald Trump. I hope he never, ever occupies a political office again. And I'm speaking about Jim Acosta endorsed heavily the job that Kristen Welker did, which maybe says he thought it was slanted his way, which is anti-Trump. Do you agree?
Of course. I mean, look, we've seen the media repeatedly rate moderators on how well they can control their words, President Trump. That's the bottom line here. So whether it's going to be Chris Wallace, whether it's going to be Kristen Welker, if you're not actually going to be hard on Trump, and actually a lot of Democrats attacked Wallace for not being hard enough on Trump, then the idea is you're absolutely failing at your job. They don't see their job as being guiding the conversation, rather it's suppressing the Republican. And this is really the job definition of the media itself. The media sees its job as attacking Republicans and defending Democrats. They use various euphemisms for this, like fact-based reporting and guiding conversation, avoiding disinformation, and informing the public. But the bottom line is it all comes down to the same thing.
Absolutely. On the subject of North Korea, it came up. Trump suggested that he has a good relationship with the dictator Kim Jong-un. And Biden responded that talking to North Korea and saying you have good relations with that country is like talking to and having good relations with Hitler right before Hitler invaded the rest of Europe and caused World War II. Social media actually attacked that talking point. What do you think of the analogy that Biden used in that case?
It's a pretty cynical argument, because if you recall back when Obama was first running, his whole thing was that he was going to negotiate with everybody without preconditions. And the media, of course, declared that this was absolutely wonderful. When President Trump was saying similar things during his original run, the media attacked it. So we're obviously seeing a fairly blatant double standard. On a practical level, we're not going to make any meaningful headway with North Korea. North Korea has been playing every American administration, Republicans and Democrats, in much the same way. The Kim family is going to cling to power by any means whatsoever. But the Democrats and their media are guilty of very blatant double standards, in which they will say that something is perfectly fantastic when it's being said by one of their people, and it's absolutely horrible when it's being said by a Republican.
Yeah, no kidding. So takeaway, bottom line, Daniel, who won last night and why?
So President Trump definitely scored quite a few important points. He got Biden to make damaging admissions, for example, about not eliminating the oil industry, but also eliminate millions of American jobs. It would decimate the American economy. Some estimates are that it might affect as many as 10% of American jobs. This would be absolutely devastating. It's definitely going to affect Biden in certain parts of the country. It's going to affect some of the Democrats who are hoping to ride his coattails powered by Silicon Valley money. As far as the overall debate goes, President Trump picked a particular strategy in the first debate. That strategy did not work so well. He pursued a much more, I think, effective strategy of trying to reach undecided voters. I think he was effective in that regard. It's not really about rating the debate as to who won and who lost, like the Olympics. It's about deciding that this candidate knew the particular thing he needed to do. Biden managed to kind of stay on his talking points, but he slipped pretty egregiously in a few instances. The oil industry was one of those examples. When President Trump challenged him on it, he decided to use the transition talking point, which is a very fundamentally absurd talking point. If you recall, during Obamacare, the Obama administration was saying, we're not going to take away your health care plan, we're going to transition it. A lot of people remember that. You've got Biden going back, for that matter, to the old Obamacare talking points that did not take away anybody's health care plans. All these are fundamentally damaging and they're unforced errors. And President Trump made up for lost time and actually scored some goals.
Fair statement. Daniel, thanks for joining us today. And thank you, our wonderful viewers out there who have watched this today. And I want to remind you, if you want to subscribe to our text message alert system that is always free, please take out your cell phone now. Text the word TRUTH in the message box and send it to 88202. Push send. It'll automatically sign you up to get this and all of our content for free. All you have to do is look down into the palm of your hand and it'll be there twice a week. For ATP Report, I'm Barry Nussbaum.